Will you allow me a 30-second commercial? If you're interested, on the first day of each month, there's a website column that I like to write. I've been writing it now for 2-3 years. And what I try to do each month is recommend anywhere from 1 to 3 books. I always try to write a paragraph or two about something that's going to make somebody mad. A few quotes that may find their way into sermons, maybe a story. Probably next month I'll find something to say about New Zealand. But it's a very, very resourceful website, not just because I have a column there. You'll find some really fine men and women writing in leadershipjournal.net. Obviously, I'm very enthusiastic about Leadership Journal as a magazine. I'm sure it gets to New Zealand. And we think it's one of the best things there is for people in ministry. It covers everything from ministry management to, the next one that's coming out during the Christmas season is on moral issues in the ministry. We just finished one on spiritual disciplines. But leadershipjournal.net will give you all the information you want. And if you check into that, you'll at least see some of the stuff that a few of us are trying to write every month as we write from pastor to pastors. Now, we're headed into this last session, and Alan, we're going to quit at 4, right? 4:15? Oh, 4:15. Just wanted to be sure. Let's take a few minutes and do the drill again. What have you been hearing now in the last couple of hours that's important to you? What's provoked you? Help me out here. Sharpening the saw is part of the job. That would be worth the whole day. From my perspective. Thank you. Discipline. The importance of, okay?
Restoration.
The challenge of restoration. Yeah. Boy, if some of you can go home and figure that one out, God will bless you.
To stop and ask the questions.
To stop and ask the questions. What does this mean? Peter Drucker said, always ask day after day, what does this mean? Look for the underlying message under all events.
Relationships and leadership.
Yeah. Thank you, because that'll be this last hour.
You've spoken of discipline as a good thing. When does it become a bad thing?
It becomes bad. When does discipline become bad? When it degenerates into legalism or compulsion or obsession. I think a number of us have a long way to go before we get there, but that but that would be the end. You know, I was thinking about this early this morning as I was making sure I had on a piece of paper what I wanted to say today, that so much of deep biblical truth is never in a proposition form that's perfect, but it's always intention. Intention, T-I-N-S-A-I-O-N. That great truths are always somehow held in tension between two extremes. And a lot of times we don't understand that. That's much of the way biblical truth is expressed. So that we find ourselves going to ridiculous extremes that I don't think the biblical writers ever meant for us to go to. They were simply expressing truth in the tension of two extremes, the paradoxical questions. And that would be a good example, that you can go too far on discipline on this end and become compulsion-driven or so legalistic like the Pharisees, or you can go the other way and say, you know, I'm free, and hold yourself to no standard or account at all. That, by the way, is another reason why we so desperately need this issue of community. One young woman asked me a really good question in the, at the break, and my answer to that is going to be what my answer is over and over again. So much of truth cannot be appreciated if we do not have a tight community around us where truth is being mediated through a multiple of sources and receivers. It took me 45 years in life to learn that. Because I so much bought into this notion that leadership is a solitary function, that I'm flying solo. I don't know whether any of you remember an old chorus, at least we used to sing in the U.S. The words went, if you know the Lord, you need nobody else to see you through the darkest night. You can walk alone. You only need the Lord to keep you on the road marked right. We sang that song Sunday after Sunday, year after year. It was terrible theology. It was unbiblical. But that was the way a lot of us were raised. You don't need nobody else. And one day I realized at midlife, I couldn't get along without relationships. So much of truth is seen through the mediated eyes of the brothers and sisters around me. We'll get into that a little bit further. Yes, ma'am. Being with the right people? You mean on the list here? Wow. No, I just know how to tell you to do it. Let's look at those people for just a minute here. I feel so authoritative when I do that. There is an answer. Not that I know everything, but I've thought about this one a long time. These people will never barge into your life for the most part. They will only get into your life if you put them on your calendar literally weeks in advance. If you wait to the week to choose how you're going to use your time with people, the bottom four will always get to you first. This includes even your family. For a long, long time, your spouse and your children will always be willing to give you up to all the other people who need you. And you will always be willing to let that happen because the people at home aren't making any nasty sounds. And the critics in your church will become louder than the cries of your spouse and your children until it's too late. Then one day you discover that, in effect, you don't have a spouse and you don't have children because they've started to listen to other voices. But I would tell you that, and here's where the value of planning comes in, and I want to suggest to you, Jesus was a planner. You may not find many verses where he's sitting down with a pen and pencil and making out a plan, but you sure see the results of a plan as he picks his priority times and his shots as to where he spends his time. But it's very clear to me that a man or a woman in ministry needs to be working several weeks in advance, asking themselves, who are the key people during this period of time that I need to be investing my greatest energies and my best hours into? And you get them on the calendar weeks in advance. I'll give you an example in Gail's life and mine. Every year, we handpick about 13 to 15 people. And well, we pick a larger group, but it always degenerates to about 13 when we really put the challenge to them. We say, we will give you 40 Monday nights with us for 3 hours a night if you're willing to be there every night without fail, do all the assignments, vigorously participate, trim your priorities so that nothing will get in the way. If you're willing to do that, we'll sign on with you for 40 Monday nights. Now, I can tell you right now, next April, the Knights will be meeting with that group because they're in the top four. And they get into Gail's calendar and they get into my calendar because there's nothing, and right now we have two of those groups. So we have a group like that on Monday nights, and I have a group of men that meet with me at 5:30 on Monday mornings for 2 hours. And both groups are on our calendar as a top priority. At the end of this year, we will have 36 people with our fingerprints all over them. I'd rather have 36 people with that kind of development over this year than 1,000 people I preach to 40 times on Sunday. Because those 36 people are going to go somewhere. But that's an example. You have to get these people into your calendar. If every pastor ought to have regular meetings with his or her supervisor. Those ought to be on the calendar weeks in advance. Every pastor ought to have scheduled meetings with his or her teammates. At Grace Chapel, where I gave a lot of the years of my life, our whole staff knew that on Monday afternoons from 1 to 4 o'clock, you had to be in the store. Whether or not there was a scheduled meeting, you had to be in the store for those 3 hours so that I or anybody else in charge could call a meeting instantly and know you'd be there. So all of the teammates knew on Monday afternoon they had to be on the same location for regularly scheduled meetings. Well, I've already said something about the disciples. I'll tell you the same thing about lost and seeking people. I've learned that in most churches, the system does all it can to insulate the pastor from lost people. It sucks you into the middle of it, and it claims all your time to talk God words and programs and stuff like that, and you come to the end of the week and you say, I haven't had one intelligent conversation this week with an unbeliever. If you're going to have any kind of touch with the larger world, you will have to plan it in advance. You'll have to pound holes into your schedule where you can have those encounters, because the church will almost always militate against that, just like the people around Jesus militated against him having any touch with people like Zacchaeus. It's a law. Planning is everything. Any other comments, questions, hostile objections? I'm sorry.
Similarly, is there a way to avoid the bottom floor?
Yeah, you do like Rockwell, you turn your back to them. No, I'm being silly. The bottom floor, the bottom floor must be attended to. There must always be the assumption that out of the bottom floor can come some disciples, and they frequently do. So. Let's not ignore it. What we really are saying is we've got to redress the proportion. The bottom four will always go to grab your attention in one way or the other, directly or indirectly. So you've got to know how to, for example, let's look for a moment at the bleeder. In another place, in a book called Renewing Your Spiritual Passion, I call these very draining people. They look something like this. For example, very draining people are most likely to know exactly when you're most vulnerable, which would be at the end of a service. So you give the benediction, they're likely to be immediately in your face, Pastor, I got to see you for a few minutes. Or I didn't like what you said here. Or how would you, and so this happens 3 or 4 Sundays, and finally you the first thing you have to do is a wise pastor surrounds him or herself with a couple of elders who spot these people and who will be your bodyguards. And at the end of a service, they're immediately in the locality, and when these people come up to you, they step in the way and say, you know, I know you'd like to talk to Pastor so-and-so, but I noticed that every week you've been doing this. How can I help you? Because Pastor has to be available to talk to other people too. Over and over and over again, what I've discovered about the bleeders, and I don't mean to be talking disrespectfully, but They'll tie up your time for 20 minutes immediately after a service, and 4 or 5 other people who really need you will stand and wait and wait, and then finally say, oh, we'll see him some other time, and then whatever it was, the spirit of conviction or whatever, is gone. So you want to make sure that you're available in these free moments for the people who absolutely need to have an encounter with you, and that's one of the ways you train your co-leaders, is to become your bodyguards. And they begin to siphon off some of these bleeders, and the bleeder then learns that they can't get your attention every time they want it. That would be one answer. Sometimes those of us who are young, we had to learn the hard way, these people need to be talked to very, very directly and say, I notice that you feel the need to talk to me every week, and I need for you to ask the question to yourself, if Pastor talks to me every week, who doesn't he get to talk to who needs him to? And some people will awaken to the logic of what you're saying. Other people will leave you. But that's a choice they have to make. Yes, name, please. Okay. Yeah, Gail's pointing out what I should have remembered, that you can even split very draining people into two groups, and this is all intuition. It's the move of the spirit, if you please. There are some draining people that if you love them in the appropriate way and you confront them at the right moment, will climb out of that draining condition, and they can become your best disciples. So you have to know about those, who those people are. Then there are others who will just make this a career. And they go from one organization to another, and if you slight them, they will immediately go to somebody else and say, you know, Pastor, she's not really a very compassionate person. Look what they did to me. And other people will come back to you and say, you know, you really wronged that person, and because they don't know the whole story. So there are draining people who can recover out of this, climb out of this. Let's go on in the time we got and talk a little bit more about the community that I... The personal side of a leader's life. And this is a very important group. Just like I had a list a moment ago of roles that people in relationship play, let me talk on the personal side, first of all, with this notion that every one of us really needs to have people in our lives that play, I'm going to use the word coach here instead of mentor or discipler or some of the other more frequently used terms to describe someone who is a deep and powerful resource to me. Let's not let it go by that the greatest single relationship in all of history is the relationship of the Trinity. I want to predict to you in the 21st century, the doctrine of the Trinity will become one of the most important of the Christian doctrines, because in a world where there is loneliness and alienation and struggle for intimacy, some people are going back to the scriptures and beginning to realize that if God is love, then God has to have an object of his love on a peer basis, and the real model of the notion that God is love is the relationship of the Trinity. Now, in the Trinity, as you study it, you see this beautiful picture of God the Father in relationship to Jesus the Son in the period of the Incarnation. A lot of people have never isolated out the words that Jesus uses to describe his relationship to the Father. Listen to these words. I and the Father are one. He who has seen me has seen the Father. I say no words that my Father has not said. I must be about my Father's business. I will show you the way to the Father. And then, in an absolute tragic opposite way, my God, or my Father, why have you forsaken me? The ultimate suffering on the cross is the sense of abandonment that Jesus has as he bears the sins of the world. Now, here is the interesting thing about all those words, that in that culture, any son could have said those words about his father. Because the recognition in that ancient culture was that there was an intimacy between a father and a son, which was the equal to, if not superior to, the intimacy between a husband and a wife. See, we see relationships in modern culture essentially as horizontal, husband to wife. In that day, the more important relationships were vertical, father to son. Why Abraham could not conceive of life without a son. And if he could not have a son naturally, he was going to have one artificially. But he had to have a son. Because with the son, the father shares the ongoing move of the family spirit, the family power, the family capacities, the family character, the family name. And in some of the tribal societies around the world, you still see this idea of the verticality of the family line. That's where the intimacy was, in the family line. We have changed it in modern culture, and we're, in one sense, paying a severe price for that because we've lost a deep sense of intimacy as a result. Now, you watch Jesus, and you listen to words like, listen to these words from the Father to the Son. This is my beloved Son. I am pleased with him. And the second time those words are heard on the mountain, there is added, listen to him. Gail points out to me that in all relationships, particularly from parent to child, there are three messages we are always supposed to send. They are the message of belonging, you belong to me, the message of competency, I see in you the capacity to do this, the message of value, you're very special to me. And when a child does not hear that from the father or the mother, one of those three or all three, when they are absent in the dialogue of the relationship, that's what creates the wounds and the anger and the hurt that so often happens when relationships are not working. Even in a marriage, those are the three most important messages we're sending to each other. Those are the embedded messages in I love you. You belong to me, I belong to you. You are capable and I celebrate your great capability. You are valuable to me and I see in you the treasure of life. And when we hear those messages, we grow like a flower does in a beautiful climate. So when the Lord comes out of the waters of baptism, where he's identifying with the sins of all the people around him, and he could have gone through a crisis of personal confidence, did I do the right thing? Have I denied myself? He hears the words of the Father, you're my son. I'm delighted with you. I'm pleased with you. Now that's the message of a coach. The father to the son, the mother to the daughter, the coach to the player. You're my son. I'm pleased with you. That's what we go to hear from this person in our lives. There's got to be someone or some people in our lives who speak that language into our hearts. And when we don't get that, it is a very, very restricted and suffocating experience. We need to be giving, those of us who are married in this room, we need to be conveying those messages to each other all the time. Those of us who have children, we need to be conveying these messages to our children all the time. Those of us who are pastors, conveying this message to the men and women that we are trying to create growth circumstances in to become more inclined. These are the essences of the messages of the coach. And you and I need to be hearing these messages. When you reach the upper years, coaches begin to die on you. I would say that the most prominent person who fulfills this role in my life is 93 years of age now. And one of these days, I'm going to lose him. And I can't imagine the grief that I'm going to feel in my heart when the Lord decides it's time to take him home. Because while I may only see him once or twice a year, to sit for a few hours side by side with him and talk and listen to him and draw upon his wisdom and his affirmation to me is one of the most renewing experiences I have during the year. I just love to be with him. So we all need a coach. And if we don't have one, then we are to be pitied. Sometimes there are cultures which discourage the role of the coach. They don't like to have people in their worlds that they can look up to and honor and receive this kind of blessing from. And I would suggest to you that that's an evil streak in a culture. When we do not allow some men and some women to ascend to places of great honor, whose words are to be respected and loved, who give to us the belonging, confidence, value messages we all need to hear. And I wonder sometimes if that's not one of the ways Satan works in various cultures, when we will not allow people like this to emerge, who can give us what we so desperately need. A second kind of person we need in relationships is someone who will challenge us to think. This means I've got to have some men and women in my life who are smarter than me, or smarter than me in certain areas at least, to whom I go to ask my questions and get some of my resources. Gail and I will make a big point about this in tomorrow's seminar when we talk about marital relationships in ministry. But we will talk about the importance in a husband-wife relationship of allowing God to speak through each other into the hearts of each other. And one of the ways we do that is when we allow our spouse to challenge us in our thinking, to have friends who are more competent than we are. And frankly, this is difficult for some of us who've selected the ministry, because one of the neat things about the ministry, if you feel inferior or you're a person easily intimidated, is you can create a ministry style where nobody can get to you. And you wrap yourself in the flag of your work, and you surround yourself, you become the number one and everybody else becomes number threes and fours, and no one ever challenges you. And you can avoid those kind of people who know more than you do. That's a real fault in ministry. I have tried over the years to learn how to love to be in the company of people who are better than I am, who will challenge my thinking, my ways of coming to conclusions, who will always teach me something when I'm in their presence. I've enjoyed a friendship over the years, perhaps you've come across him one time or another, with a man by the name of Tony Campolo. Tony was and I were together just a week ago with a third common friend. The three of us just spent a whole day sitting and talking. When you spend a day with Tony Campolo, you better bring a notebook and take notes, because he's going to do about 85% of the talking. And if you have to do the talking, it's going to be a frustrating day. But every time Tony talks, he says something worth hearing. And by the time the day's over, I've got my notebook filled with about 20 different sermon possibilities and 10 book titles I've got to look up and a half a dozen quotes and four new ideas, because the man is absolutely brilliant. Now, if I tried to compete with Campolo, I would lose big. Like whales, you know, I'd lose big. You've got to have a few friends like that. Got to have a few friends like that. A third person in this entourage is just the opposite. This is the listener. I need people who will allow me to vent my dreams, my frustrations, who know how not just to wallow with me in self-pity, but who do know how to help me by listening to me and sorting out the order of my thought. One of the reasons I fell in love with my wife from the very first day I met her was that she was one of the first people who was willing to listen to me. I'd done a lot of dating in college. Told her that one day when I was a little bit miffed at her about something. I said, I'll have you know, I dated a lot of women before I met you. And she said, I can understand the high turnover. But you know, and I'm being deadly serious, I loved her because she listened to me. She took my dreams seriously, even if they were just crazy. And I can remember those first days that we were together, as I would go on and on and on as this ambitious, visionary young man, and she would, boy, that sounds great. I can see how that would work. Yeah, that would be wonderful. It meant so much to me to have someone who listened to me, even if 9 out of 10 of my ideas were just crazy. You got to have somebody in your life who listens. And even among us who are married people here, it goes both ways. And those of us who are men, who are preachers, we sometimes think of this as a one-way street relationship. My wife is here to listen to me. Gentlemen, you're here to listen to her. And if some of us would learn to listen, our wives would say some awfully wise things that we need to hear. A fourth element I need in my personal relationships is someone, and this is not unlike the listener, who understands me enough to see the sympathetic chords of where I am hurting. Yeah, you do have a right to feel that way. I can understand why you're discouraged. I can appreciate why you would say that. This is a person who sees life from my perspective and is on my side. Add to that a person who knows how to laugh. One of the downsides in too many ministries is it gets too serious as the years go by. And there needs to be a lot more laughter, ladies and gentlemen, in our lives than there is. If it is true, how do I get these statistics right? A child laughs, what, 350 times a day? Is that the number, honey? What's the right number? 400. 400? A child laughs 400 times a day. The average adult laughs less than 10 times a day. Something awfully wrong about that. The older we get, the more we need to laugh. And you laugh with other people. So who in your close, intimate circle of 15 is the person who makes you laugh? I hope Gail sees me as a person she can laugh with, but I know that she has one friend she calls her laughing friend. And she's accurate about that, because when these two women get together, as they do with some degree of frequency, at the end of the day, they both go their separate ways, just sore sides from laughing. They know how to make each other laugh. And when you're with Campolo, you do a lot of laughing, too. I need a person who will correct me, who's willing to show me where I'm wrong and be unafraid to say so, in respectful and loving terms, of course, but nevertheless will tell me. We're talking about the person who's a rebuker here. I can't get to this subject without telling an old story. I had to write an article for Leadership Journal a couple of years ago on the subject of rebuke, and I made a list in preparation of that article and what I called the 25 top rebukes I've received in my life. And I tried to find out, what did those great rebukes have in common? For example, one of the most powerful of those rebukes came when I was in my 30s. I had gone to Japan to preach, and I was with a partner, a man a little bit older, much older than me, who was preaching along with me. And we were in Yokohama, Japan, and we were walking down a sidewalk, crowds of people all around us. And the name of a third party that we both knew well came up, and instinctively I said something really mean, cruel about that person. And my friend turned right around instantly, and he faced me about 12 inches away, and he said, "Gordon, a man who loves God would never say a thing like that about a friend." That's a rebuke. That's a correction. And it hurts. It's embarrassing. It's humiliating, but it's true. And I've thought about that rebuke often, because every time I have the temptation to say anything about any human being, whether I know them or not, that rebuke comes to mind as if it was given just yesterday. And I think to myself, that man, 30 years ago, has saved me 10,000 times over from making a fool of myself. Because that rebuke is still operational today. A man who loves God does not say that kind of thing about another person. 25 rebukes like that can make a person a pretty good person. If I could only find 50 more rebukes, I might be perfect. But who are the people in your life who are free enough and loving enough and frank enough to correct you when you're off base and out of bounds? Who will look you in the eye and say, "I don't like your tone of voice"? Who will tell you your schedule is out of joint? Who will tell you that you're just not keeping your word? We all need in our personal relationships someone who fills that function. Don't think this one to be silly. Who plays with you? Again, it goes back to the subject of laughing. Ministry gets so serious, and by the way, ministry seems to know no boundaries, therefore we really don't know how to stop the work, most of us. And what's the first thing that work encroaches on? Any opportunity for leisure or play. Gail and I would never have posed this as a challenge or a difficulty until our children grew up into their upper teen years. And then, you know, they played a very dirty trick on the two of us. It broke our hearts. They left home. They went off to college. And you know, our daughter, Christy, who at the age of 5 or 6 would sit on my lap at the end of every meal in the evening, and she'd put her arms on my neck and she would say things like, "Daddy, I will never leave you." And I would say, "Honey, someday you're going to leave." "No, Daddy, I'll never, ever leave you." I'd say, "Honey, someday a handsome young man is going to come along and you're going to fall in love with him and he's going to sweep you off your feet and you're going to leave your old dad." No, Dad, if that happens, he'll come and live with us because I'm never going to leave you. Well, he came, and she left. And you know what happened to Gail and me? We had built all of our family fun around those two kids. We were there at virtually every game, every concert, every drama, everything that was important, and we had fun all the way up to the top with those kids. We have almost no regrets about the time spent with our kids. But when they left, we just filled all the holes that they vacated with more work, more meetings to speak at, more articles to write, more people to see. That seemed to be the appropriate thing to do. And you know, the whole church world clapped. Oh, aren't you wonderful? You're godly people, and yeah, you're so sacrificial. But we came awfully close to losing a very important element of our relationship. It was the joy and the resuscitation, the refreshment that comes in a relationship when two people know how to play together. And we had to learn all over again how to play without the children. Now we do a pretty good job of it, real good job. We've earned PhDs in play. But you know, the church will never encourage you to play for the most part. It'll never challenge you to take more time off, to enjoy your spouse, to enjoy your kids, to enjoy your closest friends. The system simply isn't constructed that way. But if play doesn't show in your calendar, and if there are not people in your personal relationships with whom you can play in a very genuine way, it's going to cost you dearly in the second half of life. Finally, in my personal relationships, I need someone, some people, with whom I can unashamedly and with great freedom seek God. A lot of us have friends we've never prayed with except to ask the blessing at the meal. A lot of men in Christian leadership don't know how to pray with their wives. We don't really know how to encourage each other on to Christian growth. And to that extent that we don't have that kind of relationship with some people in our lives, we incur a serious loss and a serious vulnerability. Now, as you look at this list, with the questions in the circle, I just challenge you to ask the question, who are the people who fill these various bills? Now, don't think of one friend per line item. For example, I could show you how Gail is operational in virtually every one of those lines, and I hope I am to her. I can show you where other people play a role in two or three or four of those, and others in two or three more. But in my inner 15, there better be people who can help me have those kind of relational experiences. To the extent that they're absent, I am going to hurt, and I'm going to be vulnerable to things which I'd rather not have happen or experience. So when you look at the Christian leader's life and relationship, and you look at what Nouwen said, the important thing to ask is, as a leader, how balanced am I in both my public and my private communities? Because that's going to have a long way to answering the question as to whether or not I'm a healthy, sustaining person. Now, let me show you one or two more things, but very, very briefly, because I think I may have outlived my welcome here, and it may be just time to really call quits on this. But you'll notice that we've talked about core relationships in this wheel. Tomorrow, Gail and I will talk about family, so I'm going to leave this one out. But I want to add two more to the circle. Let's go back here for just a second. I'm going to leave this one out. Because it's covered in books like Ordering Your Private World and to some extent in the new book, A Resilient Life. But one of the places where men and women in Christian leadership really have to keep working hard is in the area of their work habits. Years ago, I heard an old pastor say to a group of young pastors where I was in the audience, he said, "Your congregation gives you one of the greatest gifts any human being can give to another, and that's the gift of time. There are actually people who are out in the marketplace right now earning a living so that you and I could be here." And every week or every 2 weeks or a month or a year, they put money in the offering plate that allows us to live and to serve the kingdom more or less full time. That's an incredible gift. We better use that gift well. And that means that in the habits of my work, I can't afford to be wasting time doing things in a sloppy fashion. I owe the people who have given me this gift effective, productive, results-centered work that's measurable and observable. And I simply want to challenge those, particularly those of you who are young. Because what we're noticing in ministry today, after I got in my last years of organizational leadership, I began to see this happen, and it was really bothersome to me. We were watching more and more young men and women coming into ministry who didn't want to be supervised, who didn't want to be held accountable, who didn't want to work according to a plan, who didn't like to be, at the end of the year, appraised and reviewed. They just thought that they were free to serve Jesus and collect a paycheck for doing it. Life isn't like that, in ministry or out of it. True work has to be evaluated and supervised. And every one of us in this room, if we're in an organization, we have both the right and the necessity to be supervised by someone who is always measuring our work habits. And one of the places where ministry is really struggling today is the poor work habits of a lot of people who never had to work for anybody. The last area is simply to know my enduring beliefs. Here's the tension again. The person who has no beliefs, in effect, where everything is up for negotiation, or the person for whom everything is an enduring belief and becomes so rigid and unchanging that you have a real problem. What are your enduring beliefs? What does Paul mean when he says, watch your life and doctrine closely? That's the great question. And with regularity, I need to I need to quiet down, I need to ask myself the question, what do I believe in enough that in effect I would put my reputation, my integrity, even if necessary, my life on the line for? To know my beliefs is a very important thing. And perhaps at another occasion we can talk more about that. I met a man here today who's a retired officer in the Salvation Army, and I was glad I quoted William and Catherine Booth this morning. Let me end this afternoon with another Salvation Army officer quote. There was a great officer, Commissioner Samuel Logan Brengle, who back in the early part of the 1900s had a fabulous evangelistic and spiritual life ministry in the Army and among people of that persuasion. Brengle once wrote, "Spiritual leadership is not won by promotion, but by many prayers and tears. It's attained by confessions of sin and much heart-searching and humbling before God, by self-surrender, a courageous sacrifice of every idol, a bold, deathless, uncompromising, and uncomplaining embrace of the cross, and by an internal, unfaltering looking unto Jesus crucified." Spiritual leadership is not gained by seeking great things for ourselves, but rather, like Paul, by counting those things that are gained to us as lost for Christ. That's a great price, but it must be unflinchingly paid by him who would not be merely a nominal, but a real spiritual leader, a leader of men, a leader whose power is recognized and felt in heaven, on earth, and in hell. Those are pretty profound words. You don't hear them often in our modern culture. I have to go back 100 years sometimes to hear things like that. But I covet them for myself and I covet them for you. So here we are in this wheel. And the question is, where do you feel exposure? Because if you don't stand the test of time and grow as the years go by, it's most likely that the weakness lies in one of these spokes on the wheel. And my hope is that as a result of this day, that you and friends or a spouse will be able to go apart for some Sabbath moments and find out the places where God may be speaking into your life. That's what it means to live the life of a leader, and I hope some of it's helpful for you. let's take a few more minutes and talk with each other. Again, questions or themes that are important to you that may need to be enlarged upon. Let me put that back up. I should have left it there, and it can become the script of the morning, this afternoon. But in the last minutes we've got, what would you like to talk about before we go home? I'm open to any questions. I'll start on the left.
Well, just so much of your wisdom is obviously gleaned from a pretty wide reading practice. Are you able to share with us just how you've managed to pursue that discipline in your life, the wide reading?
The reading discipline? I guess it begins with the fact that I'm a pretty strong introvert. Again, Gail and I will talk about that a bit tomorrow. But so for introverts, books are wonderful because they allow you to separate out yourself from everybody else and be alone. And so I can remember at the age, my grandmother taught me to read when I was 4 and 5 years of age by studying the Pauline epistles. Drove me batty, but I did learn to read. And so I was very quickly into books in those days and came to just love words and the work of authors. And it's just been a reading tear ever since. But as I got older, I began to see, even as a preacher, that if I was going to be resourceful for my congregations, I was going to have to be taking in the ideas, not just of people who were friendly to my tradition and persuasion, but people who challenged it, both in the world of theology and the Christian movement, and in the larger anti-Christian world. I needed to be in touch with the people who are influencing culture, the artists, the poets, the playwrights, the cinema, every place where people are able to convince and persuade people. I felt I needed to know something about that. And so early in the game, I continued to enlarge that hunger. So that I can't imagine a day going by without, and this would be true for my wife too, that that we don't have our fingers on a book of some type somewhere during the day. I would like to think probably on most days I average anywhere from 40 to 60 minutes of reading, and sometimes a lot more than that. I get up early to read, and it's worth going to bed earlier in the evening so that you can get up at 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning and have time to do something like that. I take very seriously when someone says to me, have you read so-and-so? And I listen carefully, and more often than not, I'll write down in my PDA the title and the author that someone speaks. It's fascinating to me how often I will say to someone, you know, you ought to get into such and such a book, and you know, I'll do that sometime, but they never write it down. And you know 9 times out of 10, it's gone in one ear and out the other. And then later on they'll say, how come you do so much reading? So I take seriously the recommendations of people. I read the book reviews in the New York Times every Sunday. That for me, you can get that on the internet, is a very important source of reading the larger literature. Magazines like Christianity Today will give you the world of the Christian literature. Gail and I really try to avoid so much of the Christian literature of today, which is very frothy. It's just, it's embarrassing to go in most Christian bookstores today and see the pulp which is being produced. So you look for men and women who are substantial authors and read everything. Read authors rather than titles. And make sure you don't read just the safe stuff where the author is preaching to the choir, but stretches you to think and react and respond. I'm not that hot on novels because they consume me. If I get into a novel, I can see myself sitting up till 3 in the morning to finish it. So novels are not real good for me. I treat myself to a novel on a trip to New Zealand on the plane or something like that. But give me a biography, and that would be my favorite kind of reading. I'm reading a new biography of George Washington right now, and great, great book. But I love to challenge people to get into biography, to study character growth and life, and that's the way it goes. That's a great question. And every time I'm asked it, my mind goes blank. I'm just going to come off the top of my head. There's an older book that was published about 30 years ago that's still in print, but if you can get it, it'll be a wonderful mind bender. It's called Shantung Compound by Langdon Gilkey. Gilkey was a professor at the University of Chicago. And he spent 3 years in a prison camp in Manchuria with a whole community of New Zealand, Australian, Dutch, British, American people who were arrested by the Japanese and forced to live in a tight community for 3 years. And it is a wonderful study on the behavior of human beings under pressure. That would be a really, it is such a contemporary book for our world today, and I would recommend that. I'd reckon for a biography, oh, Shantung, S-H-A-N-T-U-N-G, Compound by Langdon Gilkey. A biography, this is an American biography, but I think this man is known the world over in Christianity. The new Jonathan Edwards biography by George Marsden, M-A-R-S-D-E-N. It's a serious, scholarly biography, but very, very readable. You will not get dragged down into minutia and detail. Great biography. It was published about a year and a half ago. It received a Book of the Year award. Great, great book. That would be... you really ought to read some of my wife's books. High Call, High Privilege is a book for women married and in leadership, or married to people who are in leadership. I'm sorry we don't have copies here. I wish they'd been available, but I'll just say it quite frankly. It's a great book, and really needs particularly for women, but the men who read it love it too. High Call, High Privilege. Anything by Richard Foster, Eugene Peterson, these are well-known names. Dallas Willard probably is the writer of the generation in spiritual things, but you can only probably read most of Dallas's books 3 and 4 pages at a time. It's so dense and intense that so I can read it very, very slowly. But it's stuff to have in the library. If you look at my column each month, I try to keep giving you book titles.
Close group, about sort of 15 to 18 people. That's a fair number to be developing a really close relationship with. Mm-hmm. It seems to me anyway.
Ask me the last sentence again.
That seems to be a fairly large number of people to be developing quite a close relationship with, sort of 15 to 18.
Well, if you think about it, in terms of your personal relationships, 15 to 18, there's your spouse, there are your children, there are your grandchildren. There is room for about 4 or 5, in my case, male friendships, and 3 or 4 other friendships with couples that Gail and I enjoy, and I'm up to 18 pretty quickly. And that would be the group.
Just a question. You mentioned about some of those imputters like coaching thinking. It just seems to me that the further on you get, becomes kind of there about those kind of people, and you only know who you know. And a lot of people at those kind of levels don't actually make themselves available, or they get, we can operate that more than the other areas of ministry. So it's quite hard, and often you don't, it's hard to pin down those people.
Hard to pin these kind of people down. This is work. It's a form of work. It's not an arduous form of work like scrubbing a floor. But you have to be proactive to have good friendships. That's what I didn't understand until I was about 47. When, you know, I started out this morning and told you about the most devastating moment of our lives. And one of the values that came out of that period, if you can talk about value, was my recognition that one of the reasons I was where I was is because I had not cultivated male friends. I knew lots of men that I could have lunch with and have good times with, but I trotted around the country saying, you know, my wife is my best friend, I don't need any more friends. Now I realize that I was really, in a sense, asking too much of my marriage and my wife. She can't be everything to me. It's impossible. Men need some men and women need some women in their lives, because there are issues and perspectives that only men understand about men, and the same with women. You know, there are things that I might say to Gail and she'll look at me and say, oh, grow up. But if I say it to a man, he'll say, yeah, I really understand. So I had to set out at the age of 46, 47 to make some male friends. I mean, to take the men I knew and say, are there some guys here who will really bond with me in the most sincere way, and there will be reciprocity in our relationship, where we will seek each other out, and we will get on our schedules. That's the problem with so many of us men. Women are very, very good at this, but the problem with men is we are not relational by nature. We're competitors. We're warriors. And while culture often encourages women from the very beginning to bond together and talk, I mean, there's even research that Gail can talk about that says that women have a particular hormone that as times grow more and more critical, women bond with each other. Men will separate from each other in moments like that. So there's something in the mind of men that has to be overcome. And we have to say, I need some good friends. I need brothers that I can deeply love and who will love me and who will be there and who create a different kind of intimacy than the one I have with my spouse. That takes work. And it took me 2 or 3 years to identify 4 or 5 men that I could really feel close to. It took work. It took scheduling and finding those guys. And, you know, some guys don't want to play. But if you make this a value, it'll pay off. It'll happen. It won't happen overnight, but it will happen. You see, excuse me, I'll go one more step further. This is even almost harder for men who are pastors because we have created political systems in our churches where we're at the top of the heap. We're at the king of the mountain. We have the answers, and all of our relationships are people coming to us to get the answers. And somewhere along the line, you have to surrender that and say, I'm not going to be one and everybody else is going to be three, but I'm going to be one of ones. And in this moment, I'm not Pastor MacDonald, I'm Gordon, with all my, you know, my strengths and weaknesses. And I'm going to have some men in my life who will treat me like Gordon and not like Pastor. And that's not easy, but it's worth it when you get it.
The meetings that you're having on the 40 Monday nights.
Yes.
I take it that you're investing your life in other people. How are you doing that exactly? What are you doing?
What are we doing the Monday nights?
Yeah.
Secret. We do a number of things with them. This may sound crazy to you, but the first thing we do is we teach them how to read. Most people read, but they don't read analytically, and they don't read with a mind to discuss what they're reading. Very, very challenging to get people to do this. And so we start from the very beginning, and almost every week there's a reading where we give them an article or a chapter from a book or some excerpt from someplace, and everybody comes having read it, and then we read it aloud to each other in the circle. There's something about reading aloud in a group that is very, very powerful. You hear people give different tones of voice and interpretation to the reading. And every couple of paragraphs, you stop whoever's reading. You're going around the circle. Why don't you read paragraph one? And you guys read the second and third paragraph. And you read the fourth paragraph. And you stop at the end of the second paragraph. You say, now, what do you hear the author saying here? Now, Christians almost always want to immediately tell you how they disagree with the author or why they agree with him. That's not the question. We want to know, what's the author saying? We'll find out whether we agree later on when we've given the author a fair hearing. So we learn how to determine what the author is saying. Questions like, what are the key words in this paragraph? What's the most important phrase? What knocked you out of your socks here? So they learn to read, and every week we have something that we read with each other, and that often takes an hour. The second thing we start doing is we get them into brief biographies, which will get longer and longer until by the end of the year, everybody has a person, a man or a woman they've picked that they study. And later on in the year, each person will come at a given time to report to the group about the person that they've studied. And that's a very interesting process. This last year, for example, one of the men in our group, who's only been a believer for 2 years, he studied the life of Jim Elliot. I suppose you know who Jim Elliot was. Well, he'd never heard of Jim Elliot. It was really fascinating to see someone who knew nothing about Christianity over a long period of time, never heard of Jim Elliot, read Elizabeth, his sister's biography of her brother, and come alive to Jim Elliot. You can't believe this guy, he said, as if we'd never heard of Jim Elliot. You know what he did? You can't believe this. And he was reading excerpts from the book, and he was just turned on and enthusiastic as all get out about Jim Elliot. Another man, William Wilberforce. Never heard of Wilberforce before. So you get into biography. Then Gale teaches temperament. We get into Myers-Briggs temperament. Everybody learns about temperament, and they learn what their temperament code is. We get into spiritual gifts so that everybody learns what their gifts are. We study Christian character. And then one of the things we do during the course of the year, which will drive a few of you nuts, everybody tells their story. They get a full hour to open their lives to the rest of the group. And this is an incredible experience. As people, for the first time, go back and they ask, how has God so shaped my life to bring me where I am today? And this will turn out to be a 12 to 15 page manuscript in most cases. And after they've told their stories, we all ask them questions. And after the questions, we all gather around that person and lay hands on them and pray for them. And when the group has told all their stories, you have an intimacy in that group you cannot believe. These people don't want to ever separate. They forgot that we're only 40 Monday nights. What? 40 Monday nights is over? And, you know, last year's group is still meeting. Gail and I are on to a new group. But they're still going on because they've learned to love each other. But and I can't tell you what storytelling means in a fellowship. Don't tell me that you're unwilling to tell your story, because then you're denying yourself one of the greatest things the Bible gives us, and that's the stories. So, those are some of the things we do. Thank you. We have about 20 great biblical leaders we look at, men and women, and we analyze their lives like a biography. We often start with, who do we start with? We start with
Nehemiah, Ezra,
Moses.
And Esther, and Moses. Yeah, you said Moses. And then they teach them to pray, because many of them have never prayed out loud.
Yeah, many of these people have never prayed out loud or prayed in a group. And so we teach them to pray, and that's fun too. By the end of the year, they go around laying hands on people all over the place. You can't stop them. It's just somebody else.
For the sake of people who speak differently, could you define the word exposure?
We've gone through this whole day. Exposure is a word that we use in our language. I should have thought about that. It's really a way of saying, this is an area where if I am weak, this is an area of potential weakness. I'm exposed at this point. I'm not protected. And I'm likely, if at this part of my life, I'm going to repeat it, the word weakness. This is the place where Satan's likely to get me, if he can get me any place. Thanks for clarifying that. Back there.
Your group of guys that you meet with, in a pastoral setting, would you meet with guys who are in your church, and how intimate can you divulge the struggles you would have as a pastor? Or does it need to be outside of the church?
Gail and I would have told you when we were younger that it has to be outside the church. And then one day we realized this was really not the way to define it. It has to be with people who are mature enough and wise enough to know your situation and who know how to keep confidences. For example, we at Grace Chapel, where we were for many, many years, we finally had a group going, and for years that group met every month. And I suspect we went for 8 or 9 years that way, and no one ever knew the group existed. Everybody in that group recognized that for our good, they had to keep the existence of this group a total secret. Because they knew that other people would be hurt and disappointed that they were not included, that there were all kinds of downsides if the group ever was known. So, but we had allied ourselves with people who were wise and mature enough that they didn't need to tell other people that they got to be with Gordon and Gail every month. So, and the secret never leaked. Even my own pastoral staff, you know, the small groups director would say, Gordon, you got to be a member of a small group. I'd say, I am a member of a small group. Well, who's in the group? We got to put it in the church directory. I said, not going to tell you. And he never did find out who was the small group. Drove him nuts, you know. But so my point would be not whether they're in the church or out of the church, but are they mature enough that they don't need to tell other people that they're close to you as a way of building up their own self-esteem. And that does take some careful selection. They need to appreciate the vulnerability of your situation if other people know. They're not only mature enough to keep this quiet, but they're mature enough so that they can hear you talk on a personal basis about things you're struggling with, but not necessarily use that against you when you have to take a stance in public that may be just slightly different than that. That takes a lot of careful selection. And Gail and I worked hard at that.
But that group is not the group that you were talking about there. These are two different groups.
Yes.
The group that we would be doing discipling, we would not talk about problems that we're having on the ministry today.
No, this, I understood. We're talking about two different groups here. What we call the Monday night group, we call LDI. It's Leadership Discipleship Initiative. And everybody knows it as LDI. It's not, nobody volunteers to get into that. We handpick. The other group that you and I are conversing about right now is our more personal group of people that we meet as peers.
People we're going to die with.
Yeah, people we're going to die with. One of us died this last year, and we were together at that moment. Well, it's 4:16, Alan. It's time to pull the curtain down. People got to go on and do better things. Thank you very much for a good day. It's been great to be with you.